Hi everyone, I hope you're able to see me and listen to me. So if everything is clear, let me begin the class. So shall we start with the MCQ discussion in rhinology for today? Hi Kiranmay, hi Vikas, hi Ashu. So if everything is fine, should we begin with the class? Okay. So we'll begin with the first MCQ. After an endoscopic sinus surgery, a patient developed periorbital ecchymosis and blurring of vision. The cause of this is sphenopalatine bleeding, anterior ethmoidal artery bleeding, internal maxillary artery bleeding, facial artery bleeding. So please let me know what you think is the answer in the chat box below. So once you tell me your view or what you think is the right answer, after that I will be telling you what's the correct answer. So it is Arankil Gay says A. Manali Rathod says anterior ethmoidal artery bleeding. What about the others? What do you think is the answer for this question? So after endoscopic sinus surgery, a patient developed periorbital ecchymosis and blurring of vision. What is the cause of this? Sneha Rajan says it's 4. So the main artery that is responsible for causing this periorbital ecchymosis and blurring of vision is your anterior ethmoidal artery. How? So you see here we have got the ethmoidal air cells. These ethmoidal air cells are supplied by your anterior ethmoidal artery. So your anterior ethmoids, in the roof of your anterior ethmoids is your anterior ethmoidal artery. So when you are doing a functional endoscopic sinus surgery and you are opening up the anterior ethmoids, there is a very high likelihood that you may damage the anterior ethmoidal artery. So if it happens that you damage the anterior ethmoidal artery, what will happen? So if you are able to control that bleeding in the nasal cavity or in the sinus, in the anterior ethmoidal sinus, if you are able to coagulate it, good. Now if you cannot coagulate this bleeder, if it continues to bleed, the thing that will happen is it will quickly get retracted into the orbit. Now, if it gets retracted into the orbit, so we know that it's a branch of your ophthalmic artery. So if it gets retracted into the orbit, it will result in orbital hematoma. And if there is an orbital hematoma, it will compress on the optic nerve, resulting in decreased vision initially, and later there may be blindness. So when you are doing a functional endoscopic sinus surgery, you have to be very, very careful about the bleeding from anterior ethmoidal artery. And if you find a bleeding at anterior ethmoidal artery area, you have to coagulate it even before it retracts. And if there is an orbital hematoma that forms, the first thing that you do if there is an orbital hematoma is in the ward is you're going to do a lateral canthotomy. So once you do a lateral canthotomy, you're giving the hematoma or you're giving the orbit to expand, and as a result the compression on the optic nerve is reduced. So you do a lateral canthotomy. And finally, you will do a orbital decompression, which will take some time. So the first step to decompress is lateral canthotomy, and finally you'll do an orbital decompression. So I hope you guys understood quickly about anterior ethmoidal artery bleeding and its clinical significance while doing a functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Fine. So let's go to the second question. Killian's incision is used for submucosal resection of the nasal septum, intranasal antrostomy, Caldwell-Luck operation, myringoplasty. So Killian's incision is used for what? Is it used for submucosal resection of the nasal septum? Is it used for intranasal antrostomy? Is it used for Caldwell-Luck operation, or is it used for myringoplasty? Okay, Raj is saying it's A. What about the others? Mahesh Saini says C. Surendra says A. Sneha Rajan says B. Everybody else, please try to attempt. Okay, so let me just explain to you what is Killian's incision and what is Freer's incision. If you take a incision on the caudal margin of the septum, so this is your caudal margin of the septum where the mucoperichondrium and the cutaneous or the skin meet. So this junction is called as the mucocutaneous junction. So if you make an incision at the mucocutaneous junction, you call that incision as Freer's incision. But if you make an incision about 1 to 1.25 centimeter behind the mucocutaneous junction, that incision is called as Killian's incision. So Killian's incision is about 1 to 1.5 centimeters, 1.25, sorry, behind the caudal margin of the septum. So Freer's incision is used for a surgery which is called as septoplasty. Killian's incision is used for a surgery which is called as submucous resection. So these are the two incisions which are used in septum. For SMR you use a Killian's incision, for septoplasty you use a Freer's incision. So I hope you guys got it. Let's go to the next question. A man is brought in the emergency after being involved in a motorbike accident. So there was a trauma. The patient complains of nasal swelling and epistaxis. On examination, there is a pink mass on the both sides of the septum. Which of the following is an acute complication of this condition if left untreated? So they're telling you after trauma, there was patient who complained of nasal swelling and epistaxis, and there was a pinkish swelling on the either side of the septum. So what do you think is the diagnosis? And what will happen if it is left untreated? Sinusitis, anosmia, rhinitis, saddle nose deformity. So Raj says C. What about the others? Shravan Prince says D. Raj says A. Okay, please try to attempt. I'm giving you about 30 seconds time to think about the answer. Shubham and Surendra feel A. Okay, so what do you think is the diagnosis here based upon the history when there is a history of trauma? After that, there is a bilateral pinkish swelling on either side of the septum. Can we think about septal hematoma? That is the cause for this pinkish swelling on either side of the septum. So if there is a septal hematoma, can this progress to a septal abscess if it is not drained immediately? And if there is septal abscess, can it result in necrosis of the cartilage? And if there is necrosis of the cartilage, can it lead to a saddle nose deformity? So this is the question here. So here they're asking you, what is a complication if it is left untreated? The answer will be saddle nose deformity. Sinusitis, anosmia, rhinitis could occur, but mostly as a delayed complication, or may not occur as a complication, but as a direct implication of septal hematoma, you may have a septal abscess, and that septal abscess may lead to saddle nose deformity. Let's go to the next question. A 25-year-old presents with nasal obstruction, epistaxis, intermittent nasal whistling, and a saddle nose deformity. What is the most likely cause of this patient's primary problem? Cocaine use, exposure to gas, nose picking, septal surgery. So they're telling you there is a 25-year-old patient who complained about nasal obstruction, epistaxis, intermittent nasal whistling, and a saddle nose deformity. What is the likely cause of this patient's primary problem? Surendra Kesi, yes, acute complication of a septal hematoma is a septal abscess. Untreated septal hematoma could result in a septal abscess. So I hope you got the answer for your question. So for this question, I think the answer is between B, D, A. What about others? What do you think is the answer? So here, since they're telling you that there is a patient who is having nasal obstruction, epistaxis, intermittent nasal whistling, and a saddle nose deformity, all these are in favor of a septal perforation. So this septal perforation, a small perforation, typically will present to you with whistling sounds. Large perforations typically will present to you with nasal obstruction and intermittent epistaxis. Now, in this patient, they have told you that clearly that intermittent there is whistling sound. So, which means that this is not a major symptom and this is your major symptom. So, what is the primary cause of this problem? Now, one very important key that they have given to your question is saddle nose deformity. Now, cocaine abuse, exposure to gases, nose picking, septal surgery, all of this can result in septal perforation. All the options that are given are a cause of your septal perforation. But because of cocaine abuse, because of exposure to gases, because of nasal picking, you will get a small perforation, not a large perforation. Whenever there is a large perforation and a saddle nose deformity, you must think of a septal surgery, which is your submucosal resection. So if you have done a submucosal resection where you have resected a piece of cartilage and a piece of bone, there may be loss of support to the dorsum of the nose resulting in saddle nose deformity. So in this particular condition or MCQ, the answer is more in favor of septal surgery. Got it? All of you got this MCQ? Fine. So let us go to the next question. In management of epistaxis, posterior nasal packing should be the first line of therapy, should not be performed with anterior nasal packing, requires the patient to be monitored for hypoxia, apnea, and arrhythmia, may predispose to hypocarbia. So answer whatever you think in the chat box below. So the answer, some of you are telling C. What about others? What do you think is the answer? So they have given you a question in managing epistaxis. Posterior nasal packing is not the first line of therapy. The first line of therapy begins with your Trotter's method, where you pinch the nose and bend forward. Then you send the patient for endoscopic examination. On endoscopic examination, if you find a single bleeding point, you are going to cauterize that single bleeding point. If you see multiple bleeding points, you will do an anterior nasal packing. If the anterior nasal packing fails, then you are going to go for posterior nasal packing. And if the posterior nasal packing fails, then you will go for ligation of arteries. So this is the order of treatment or management protocol for epistaxis. So is posterior nasal packing the first line of therapy for epistaxis? No. So this is false. Should not be performed with anterior nasal packing. This is also false because posterior nasal packing is often supported with anterior nasal packing. Okay, so the next thing requires the patient to be monitored for hypoxia, apnea, and arrhythmias. So, whenever you have done a posterior nasal packing with an anterior nasal packing, like you can see in the clinic picture here, where they have put a balloon and occluded the nasopharynx, and they have done an anterior nasal packing where they have done complete occlusion of the nasal cavity from the vestibule anteriorly to coina posteriorly, from roof of the nose to floor of the nose. Since your airway is completely obstructed, the patient may have hypoxia, and because of hypoxia, there may be carbon dioxide retention and can be hypercarbia. Hypoxia also, especially in sleep, can result in apnea, and this can predispose to arrhythmias. So, this patient in whom you have done an anterior and a posterior nasal packing should be monitored for hypoxia, apnea, and arrhythmia. This is a true condition. May predispose to hypercarbia is false, will predispose to hypercarbia. Got it? So, Shravan, what epistaxis am I referring here? So, when they have not mentioned to you whether it is anterior epistaxis or posterior epistaxis, you will just go for the general management for a patient with epistaxis. See, the general management for patient with epistaxis begins with Trotter's method, and then you are going to prepare after initial medical review and resuscitation. After preparing the nose, then you will go for endoscopic examination to identify it is anterior or posterior, single site or multiple site, can it be cauterized or can it not be cauterized. After that, if it is multiple bleeding, you'll do an anterior packing. If it fails, posterior nasal packing with anterior nasal packing. If it fails, ligation of the arteries. So this is the general management for patients with epistaxis. So when they have not specified to you anterior or posterior, you will have to follow this protocol and attempt your question. Got it? Okay. The pathognomic test for CSF leak is glucose concentration test, handkerchief test, halosign, beta 2 transferrin. So, which is the pathognomic test for CSF leak? You're welcome, Shravan. So please answer in the chat box. What do you think is the answer? Which is the pathognomic test for CSF leak? Yes, many of you have answered it right. So the pathognomic test for identification of CSF leak is beta 2 transferrin, as beta 2 transferrin is present only in CSF, in perilymph, and in aqueous humor. So these three tests, glucose, handkerchief, and halosign, are also there for identifying CSF rhinorrhea, but they are non-specific. The specific test is for CSF is your beta 2 transferrin. Now in your exam, if they are asking you between beta 2 transferrin and beta trace protein, the answer will be beta trace protein, because beta trace protein is not found in any other fluid like perilymph or aqueous humor also. It is present only in CSF. So if you have an option between the two, please mark beta trace protein. If this is not there, then mark beta 2 transferrin. So let's go to the next one. Target sign is suggestive of traumatic CSF rhinorrhea, spontaneous CSF rhinorrhea, angiofibroma, glomus tympanicum. So I'm waiting for your answers. Shravan, if there is a question with multiple correct answers, you can mark both beta 2 transferrin and beta trace protein. But if there is a single best answer type of question, then your answer will be beta trace protein. Yes, so the answer here is traumatic CSF rhinorrhea. So target sign is you get a central nucleus of a red dot, and around that you have an area of halo. This is specifically seen in traumatic CSF rhinorrhea. So target sign is very much suggestive of a traumatic CSF rhinorrhea. Fine. So let's go to the next question. Strawberry skin appearance of the nasal mucosa is seen in vaginal granulomatosis, sarcoidosis, Kawasaki's disease, rhinosporidiosis. Vasvi is saying rhinosporidiosis, Surendra is saying sarcoidosis. Hello Vasvi, it's been long time that I have seen you in my classes. I hope all is well with you. So I knew most of you would answer this as D, but strawberry-like polyp is seen in rhinosporidiosis. So strawberry polyp, if they ask you, or a strawberry kind of nasal mass, it would be rhinosporidiosis. But strawberry skin like appearance of the nasal mucosa, so on the nasal mucosa you are getting multiple reddish dots, that is typically seen in sarcoidosis. So don't get confused in the exams. Strawberry like appearance of the nasal mucosa is suggestive of sarcoidosis, but a strawberry like polyp or a strawberry like nasal mass, that is suggestive of rhinosporidiosis. So I hope you understood the question here. I knew most of you would go wrong, which is why I brought up this question for discussion, that strawberry-like appearance of nasal mucosa. Mucosa itself is changing its character, that is sarcoidosis. But through the mucosa, if you have a mass, and over that mass, if you have got reddish mass with whitish sporangia, that is seen in rhinosporidiosis. Let's go to the next question. What is a rhinolith? Foreign body in the nose? Stone in the nose, deposition of calcium around a foreign body in the nose, it is a misnomer. What is rhinolith? Yes, very good. All of you have answered it right so far. Whoever have answered, Surendra, Shravan, Vasvi, Raj, Harsh, Harish, yes, it is deposition of calcium and magnesium. Usually the nucleus is like a simple blood clot, or there could be a mucus plug around which there is deposition of calcium and magnesium crystals, and this calcium and magnesium crystal will form a mineralized foreign body in the nose, which is called as your rhinolith. It is not a true foreign body, but it is deposition of calcium and magnesium crystals around a foreign body or around a blood clot or around a nucleus. This is called as rhinolith. Okay, let's go to the next question. Bernoulli's theorem explains nasal polyp, thyroglossal cyst, Zenker's diverticulum, laryngomalacia. What does Bernoulli's theorem explain? Very good. Again, many of you have answered it correctly. Bernoulli's theorem explains your nasal polyp, which is when air travels from a larger surface area to a narrower surface area. When air goes from a larger area to a narrow area, there is a negative pressure that is generated within it. So this negative pressure will pull the structures around it into the lumen. So when it pulls the structure around the lumen on chronic negative pressure, it will lead to prolapse of the nasal mucosa into that cavity, or prolapse of mucosa in that cavity to form a polyp. So that explains how nasal polyp happens when there is a DNS or when there is an obstruction to the ostium because of narrowing of the airway. There is a negative pressure that is generated. This negative pressure pulls the mucosa inwards, and once it pulls the mucosa inwards, it will result in the formation of a polyp. So this is about the Bernoulli's theorem. Rhinitis sicca is characterized by drying of anterior one third of the nose, drying of middle one third of the nose, drying of posterior one third of the nose, drying of the entire nasal cavity. This is very, very common question which has been asked multiple times. Those who work in dry weathers like bakers or who are in deserts. So exposure to chronic dry currents of air will result in a condition which is called as rhinitis sicca. Yes, so rhinitis sicca is typically differentiated from atrophic rhinitis by it is affecting only the anterior one third of the nasal cavity. It does not affect the middle third or the posterior third of the entire nasal cavity. The characteristic feature is it affects only the anterior one third of the nasal cavity. Vidian neurectomy is done in allergic rhinitis, atrophic rhinitis, vasomotor rhinitis, rhinitis sicca. So where do you do Vidian neurectomy? Okay, Astha is saying C, Surendra is also saying C. What about others? Yes, very good. Vidian neurectomy is done for vasomotor rhinitis, which is a condition where there is an imbalance between the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. So there is a sympathetic hypoactivity and there is a parasympathetic hyperactivity. So as a result of which there will be nasal blockage, nasal discharge, congestion, etc. So this condition where we have to remove the imbalance, initially you can try medical therapy, you can do conservative surgery like partial turbinectomy, etc. But if it persists, then you are going to do a Vidian neurectomy. So Vidian neurectomy is the last treatment option for a condition which is your vasomotor rhinitis. And we know allergy is an immune mediated response, so obviously there is no role of surgery. Atrophic rhinitis is primarily infectious or because of certain other causes like excessive resection of turbinates, radiation exposure, etc. Rhinitis sicca is usually seen in those exposed to dry environments. So in these conditions, there is no role of surgery at all. Vasomotor rhinitis is the only condition where you could expect doing a Vidian neurectomy. So with this, I finish my class. I would just like to get you to one of the important things that you already know, that is Econic subscription. Many of the educators have already told you, but just to remind you of it again. So this Econic subscription is, you get an Academy subscription as well as the Prepladder Sec subscription. It's a combination of both. So you get live classes and you get even video lectures and question bank as well. So you can have live tests, quizzes, rapid revision, etc. On an Academy platform, we hold free classes which are called as special classes, and we hold also something called as paid classes, which are your plus classes. So plus classes are mainly in the form of batch courses for those appearing for NEET PG, for those appearing for your FMGE, those appearing for NEET PG 2021, those appearing for 2022, etc. So you can have, those who are interested could use the code Dr. Vaishnavi 10 to get an additional 10% off if you want to subscribe to the plus course. For the free classes, you can log in to my account or you can go to the Unacademy app, open or search for my name, which is Vaishnavi, there, and you can identify or you could see all the free classes that I have taken so far. Many of the interesting classes are there which could definitely help you, where I have done lot of MCQ discussions, recent pattern questions, next pattern questions, clinical scenarios, practical ENT, and so on. So you can see those classes which are recorded. Also listen to my free classes whenever they are going to be. So if you follow me on the Unacademy app, you will get a notification whenever I do this free classes. So those who want to take paid classes could go for that. Those who want to come for free are always welcome for that. So you can take the subscription if you would like to, and you would get a 10% off if you'd use my code. And yes, with that I will just close my session, and I hope you guys liked it. Thank you all for the patient listening.